Hello everybody, my name is Walter and this is episode 4 of my Redstone development series. In this episode I will show you a third example of me designing something, in this case a one block wide tileable color combination log. So as you can see, when I flick those buttons here, I get the next color, one of 10 in this case, and as you can see the design is also rather compact and works quite nicely. In this episode, I will show you how I designed this. I will try to explain my design choices in the beginning, and later on I will run into one or two issues and I will explain to you how I decided to solve those. And that should be enough of a prologue, so let's get straight back to the designing. Okay, so before I get to actually designing this thing here, I need to make a few decisions. First of all, what do I want to build? Well, I want to design a color combination log more or less based on this one here that is only one block wide and still tileable. If you look in here, you will see that the color combination log here basically is two piston feed tapes right next to each other. One, the one in the center here, contains the colors which are pushed towards the front into this gap in the wall with this piston here. At the back I have another piston feed tape which contains only one transparent block and all other are full blocks, which means that only if the transparent block is here, this comparator here will turn off. This also means that I need a block in the center of this loop too. So I need two feed tapes, both with a gap in the center. Next decision is how many blocks I want to have in this loop here. I want to go with 10 because I think it's a nice number. And as you can see, it leaves enough space for a bit of circuitry in the center. The next step is how do I want to place the two loops. I can place the two loops behind each other. So one loop, then the next loop behind it. Or I can have one loop in the center and a bigger loop around it. The problem with the second option is that I have to make sure that when I have 10 blocks here, the outer loop has 20 or 30 blocks or something around that, so that they both stay synchronized. So I will most likely go with one loop at the front and the second loop at the back, because this is also a bit more compact and easier to build. At least I believe so at the moment. The next decision is about the shapes of the piston feed tapes. Since I need two gaps in the corners for this thing here to actually be able to shuffle around, I can go with a 3x5x5 version, a 4x4 or a 5x3 version. The 4x4 is more or less out because squares have the highest surface area for a given circumference of all rectangles, so this is out. I also want this build to be not too long, which means that this is also more or less out, because if I'm using this, the length will be around 13 or so. If I use this, it will be about maybe 9 or so, so quite a bit shorter. So I will most likely have 2 5 high and 3 long feed tapes in the back of this build here. So that's the feed tapes done. Last step is figuring out the front end. So obviously I can't have the button next to the color panel, which means now I have to place it either at the top or at the bottom of it. And those are the three combinations I think make most sense. Either the gap at the bottom and the bottom at the top, the gap at the top and the bottom below it, or the gap at the bottom here and the bottom put into the floor. The gap could also be a block above. Now, aesthetically, I don't think this one here looks too good, so I will remove that option. And to decide which of those two options I will use, I will have to make a little test first. So if I want to be able to push the blocks here directly towards the front, and I only want to do this with a single piston and not a double piston extender, this means that the feed tape is right at the back of the wall. With the button at the top, I have no way of getting the power through here except for placing an observer inside of the wall in the bottom tool's face. That would work. I could take the power from the back, for example, with a node block and then an observer looking at the node block. But I want to have this thing here looking as clean as possible, meaning no visible observers. So this is also out. And we're left with this option here, because here I have access from the bottom, which is hidden by the floor. And I can, for example, place a node block down here. So with all of that, we have our final configuration, which we will go for, which is this kind of front end and two feed tapes like this here, one behind the other. So now that we have a rough idea of what we want to build, let's actually get to the designing process. So the first step is figuring out where we want to place our first feed tape. For now, let's leave the corners all in. We will have to remove two at a later point. First, we have to decide once more something, and that is the direction of our feed tape. We can go clockwise or counterclockwise. I believe the problem we will run into is here in this corner and this corner here. Let's say we go counterclockwise. Counterclockwise means that we need a piston at this point. And that means that it would be visible from the front, except if we place some kind of ledge at the front. I want to avoid this. So this is more or less out, which means that we need to place our piston so that the entire thing here is moving clockwise. So this is the first idea. Now we have still one issue, and that is we want this thing here to be tileable. Now if we have a full block up here, and we power this full block here, we will power this piston obviously. But we would also power the pistons next to this one here, due to butt powering. So we need to move everything one block down, because then we are butt powering this piston, but not the pistons next to this. So let's quickly move everything down by one. And voila. So now we still have one problem, and that is that the button doesn't update the piston down here, but the solution is rather simply just placing the node block in here, and now it should work. And as you can see, we need a gap in here, since this is the first piston we are actually moving. So that is looking good so far. Then next step is actually placing the sticky piston in here, since we already know it has to go in there. And we can actually take the output through the movement of this block here to pull in this block here. So this is looking good so far. Now we need to decide where we want to go from here. And the simplest solution would be for now just to place two observers down here, so we have an automatic system which sends the block over and then up. So that is looking good so far. Since we are automatically moving this entire thing, we need another gap up here, which means that we can't have a gap up there, since we still need our 10 blocks in the loop. So let's see this thing in action. That is looking good so far. Now we still have one problem, and that is that as long as the button is pressed, so for 1 second, the piston down here is extended and thus blocks this piston from moving. On the other hand, if you look at this setup from here, we are moving this over, up, and this piston here can only be activated after this piston here. So this is one possible issue. Maybe this can be solved later on when we are involving a second piston feed tip here and are basically going over, then up here, and then over there, and maybe that delay will be enough for this piston already to be retracted. We will see how that goes in a moment. But for now, let's actually add a second feed tip. So now we have our second feed tape built in. I tried to make this at the same height as the other one and as close to it as possible. This glass here is just to remind me that I won't be able to have only full blocks inside of this loop here, which may cause some issues at a later point if I didn't think of that. Anyway, first of all, we need to start, I believe, down here again with this piston. I see one simple solution to powering this, and it is simply using a similar trick to before here. So now the movement of this loop here actually starts the movement of this loop here. So then we can do the same down here as we did before, which means that we need the gap here and the gap here. So far, so good. Now we need to keep in mind that we still need to have access to this side here, at least at one point, to get an output here, otherwise we won't be able to get our signal from this comparator there. So that means that we can simply have a line of observers going at the back up and then over here, unless we leave enough space for the redstone line behind the comparator, or the comparator is feeding into, which could cause other problems. So let's see what I can come up with. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem like there is a good way to get the power from down here to up there, so I decided to move the second feed tape one block towards the back, and now I have some free space here, which I can then use. First of all, let's actually use the observer here, which triggers this piston then, and this combination is even one tick faster now. Then let's go and add another observer here, then one going up, running to full block, since we need to get the power up to this piston here. Then we shouldn't have an issue with the node block here and the observer there. Then a full block here and the node block here to update that one. So let's see how this works. That's looking good so far. We still need to power this piston there, which shouldn't be too hard. We need 2 tick of delay, and then we can do this like so, and then this piston here should have one final activation, and we should be in this state here. That looks very good so far. Let's give it a test run. Okay, second feed tape is more or less finished. Now we need still the feed tape at the back here. We need to power first this piston here, and then this piston here. And we need to wait until this piston down here has retracted before we can actually push it down. And only after we have pushed it down, this piston here has to be activated once more. Since we need to activate it from the top, we can already place the observer here, because there's no other way to get the power down there. Unless we go from this side here, but there is not really a way to get an observer in this place here powered or triggered correctly. So now let's quickly recap how far we have gotten. We have the feed tap at the back working, the feed tap at the front works the bottom half, and here on the top we still need to power this piston, and then this piston here. The simplest way I can see is first placing an observer up here, which powers this piston, then the piston down here. So let's see if this works. Yeah, this seems to work. And then we still need to power this piston here, so everything resets. So let's see how this goes. That is looking very good so far. So let's see if we can't automatize this entire thing. Although let's quickly check how much delay we have here, because we still need the 10 or 11 tick of delay up here. So we have 1 tick here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There's a good chance that this will not entirely work out. So let's see. Yeah, this piston here is triggered a bit too early in the sequence, so we will have to see if there is a way to get some additional delay in here. And yeah, there is a way. So let's go like this here. That should be enough of a delay. Yeah, that's looking good so far. Perfect. We have the front feed tape, we have the back feed tape, and let's quickly silence this one here. This is a bit getting annoying. Yeah. So now we need still to put a chest somewhere in the center, and we need a way to get the signal out there. So let's put the chest, well, it's pretty much up to you whether it's here or down there. Then let's quickly fill the entire thing with blocks. Then we take an output from this side here, run this into a full block with some redstone dust on top, and that's our output actually. So I believe we are actually done. Now let's see if the output turns off, and that's looking good so far. So next step is filling in some colors and then testing whether the tileability is still working as it should. And I just found one weakness of this build here, and that is it is not spam proof. If you keep right clicking on this button here and don't give this piston down here a chance to retract, since the timing at the back here is fixed and not depending on the retraction of this piston here, the whole thing will start to split out. Come on. If you, yeah, you can see. It will start to split out a block, and then the entire thing will no longer work since we are missing a block in the loop here, and this will no longer trigger the rest of the entire system. So that's definitely one thing to keep aware of and to be certain to avoid if possible. So, or at least something that you should mention in the tutorial, of course. So, anyway, now the colors are in, we can copy this a few more times to see if it's still tileable. And it appears I actually forgot something. If I activate one of those modules, you will see that at the last action, the neighboring modules actually activate the pistons here in the center, which is due to the fact that those pistons are butt powers for those full blocks here. I can think of a couple solutions to that problem. The first would be to remove all of those full blocks here and replace them with transparent blocks, maybe stained glass or stairs, although the colors you can use there are very limited then. Another option would be to actually move down the piston one. So let's quickly do that. Let's move down the piston by one, and then let's place a node block on top. Now the piston is powered from below, like before, and from the top it's butt powered and updated via the node block. So let's quickly move this in the correct position. Now we would have to place the button on this block here, which would be this configuration, which I actually don't really like. But at least it would work that way. What I also don't really like is that the node block is visible at some point. Okay, I just had an idea. Let's actually replace the node block with a stairs. And let's power the stairs like so. That should actually... Yes, that works. So now all I have to do is actually move this up a bit and modify the other ones accordingly. And voila, so now we have those three modules working without interfacing or interacting with each other. That is looking very good here. So the modules are more or less finished. Now there is one last thing to think about at the back here, and that is if you have more than 15 modules, the modules on the edges, or those comparators on the edges, won't be able to actually power those ends of this redstone line here. So you will have to add a extension at some point. Let's quickly figure out how that works. So if I want to extend it, I will need a repeater. Let's place it here. Now this one here is not connected anymore. So we can still take an output from down here and connect it here. Although, let's actually go over here and let's do it so, because then we are using the repeater here and have the full signal strength here. Otherwise we would reduce the signal strength by 2 from here. So this would decrease the total addition or extension we can create now. Okay, so that actually seems to be all, and the thing is now finished, I believe. And of course, just as I was finishing the video, I actually had another idea, and that is to actually replace this node block here with an observer, and then moving that observer over in this direction. And if it works as I think it should, yeah, now the entire system works with full blocks and with transparent blocks. So, obvious improvement right there. And the very last step is, of course, signing the entire thing and giving it a name, so you will be able to come back a couple of years later and will still know what this chunk of redstone actually does. But anyway, that is the end of this episode. I hope I was able to show you the designing process and explain how I went into the designing process and what I based my decisions on. I also hope you enjoyed this episode, and well, see ya!